His spot always gives us a hard time. So Sierra or out of families, but what should they demand for the next 2 or 3 weeks for our families? So they're not wanting to end with loss in 3 hours. It was way outweighed by the fact that they were being boycotted for 3 weeks to start the national campaign around why happens when you strike out the next. So for us, it's really a demonstration of what we can do and that we're not completely lost Harlem. I grew up in Harlem, I was born in Harlem Hospital, I grew up in Harlem. The Brooklyn down on the east side. And Brooklyn tracks Harlem somewhat politically. When I moved out to Brooklyn in the 1980s, 1990s, it was much more politically advanced than what Harlem was at that point. Because Harlem already began its transition in terms of the, what we call, we don't call it gentrification, we call it ethnic cleansing. In Brooklyn, this had a real political also, when we began the Black History Building strike, which was, we went in full strike, we had too many meetings to bring people out, and then later we would go, different at night, we would go in full strike out. And there was one time, we went, the crack dealers called the police on us. The people who were the founders of the Center for Public Health always had a our parents, it was how good the United States was, how democratic, how, you know, how much opportunity black people had the day before that, over Winfrey. Bill Cosby before he might have the funds. The dream team, this is an example of what life is for black people. Our position was that you couldn't confuse the whatever you call success for a few people with the conditions that most black people face. Now, when you took the statistics of the quality of life of black people in every area compared to white people, and you didn't put a category on it, just the statistics started looking and say, oh, you're talking about United States and Haiti or some more or less developed country, because the statistics did not make sense for people who are supposed to be citizens in the same country. How do you have this tremendous disparity? We were like an underdeveloped, a developing country in within the borders of the United States. So that was our hindrance around. So when we got to Geneva, which is where the U.S. Criminal Rights Bodies were, answer the question of going with humans. Humans were there, and so to something we went to determine how do you, it's really an unrevolutionary function in different forms. What you do in the street is one thing, what you do in the courtroom is another, what you do in something like the United Nations is another. They said, inside the United Nations, the fight is for words, the fight is for resolutions. The United Nations can be a place that influences the national public opinion in order to support a free struggle. And said, so you may be fighting over the placement of a study hall, which in another context is irrelevant, but in terms of what we can accomplish in the United Nations is very important. And they told us that you can't come one time and make a great speech and affect anything. You have to be there every session. So when the countries that are there, when you walk in, they know what you're there for. So it was in that context that we went to the United Nations World Conference Against Racism in 2001 to try and get a declaration from the United Nations that the transatlantic slavery were crimes against humanity, because anything that's considered a crime against humanity has no statute of limitations, which means that you can't say it's like murder. Nobody can say fair arrest if they can't say, well, it's statute of limitations, which is an artificial limit that a country or a city or a state sets for prosecution of crimes. Some things have no statute of limitations. Crime against humanity is one of those. And so that's why we went to the United Nations to do that. And for people who organize, I suggest you look at a documentary called The Dirty 400. You can see on YouTube, which shows the organizing we did to actually have that happen. Because what came out of that World Conference was actually the first international declaration that what we accepted was indeed a crime against humanity and our reparations to do with the sentence of the victims. It's important, and particularly when you look at the Palestinian struggle. The way the United States dealt with this, the whole organizing around this World Conference, was the United Nations has what they call preparatory meetings before you get to the conference. They have international ones, they have ones in different regions. And so by the time you get to the conference, usually everything's worked out. The United States took the position, and of course, they always get black people to support them. They had a delegation to the first international prep conference that was headed by a black woman. And they took the United States position was, if there's any mention, if there's even any hint that there's going to be any discussion around dead color preparation, they call it compensation for restitution. They said, we will not participate in this World Conference, so they were trying to delegitimize it. A few months later, which is not good publicity, this was still, the president was at this point, it was still Clinton. The very first black president, right? So they changed the whole framework to say that really the more conscious of racism, which you hear now is anti-Semitic. Because of the anything they talk about the fighting Zionism, automatically became anti-Semitic, and it's the same thing they're doing now to create Zionism for Jews as opposed to Zionism for what it represents. And so right through to the World Conference in August 2001 here, running the Center of Arabs and Palestinian, which was not issued. The Palestinian delegation helped make it successful because the Palestinians understood that whole trope of Zionism and racism and was going to be a way of really dismantling the motion of the World Conference. So they had to back off that. Palestinians would not push that. And when you read the actual declaration of program of action, there's really nothing in it that talks negative about Israel or around Palestine. It's really neutral on that. And so we're to this day, in 2024, the United States will try to discredit the Durban Declaration by saints, present us today. And I raise that because once again the connection between the struggle of African people and the Palestinians, we reinforce each other on that. And that's one of the reasons why we think it's very important in our community to do that. We've been going to most of the demonstrations around support for Palestine. We thought it was also very important just to have in our community, so that our community, Black community, can understand that connection of why they need support. And sometimes that's not always clear. So a week and a half ago in Bethesda, we had a rally on Malcolm X Boulevard and Fulton Street, which is also Harry Tubman Boulevard. Just get people to know about that. We can attend that because we think it's very important that it happened. So they talked about simply that Harlem Peace Walk wanted to kind of support us on the 18th and also wanted to bring some literature around the connection between that, obviously supporting that. So that's where we are with that. Maybe it'll help at this point if institutions want, when we speak to Palestinian support for Palestine rallies, one of the connections before is that in terms of our history, is that we face the same. We enunciate what we say Zionism, we face racism, we face non-capitalism. And to understand U.S. support for Israel in the face of what would seem like common sense shouldn't be, they both represent the same interests. They represent the interests of imperialism. Imperialism and capitalism is based upon anti-blacks. Capitalism is based upon the theft of African labor, black labor, and continues to this day to maintain it. So it's an easy juxtaposition because those interests are really in a frenzy at this point. And what the struggle in Palestine and Gaza and West Bank represents, it really upset the apple cart in terms of what Israel was trying to do when it was on the American side of the agreement with Saudi Arabia, bringing all the Arab countries, leadership of the Arab countries, to really sell out the ethnic cleansing of Gaza. So all that's been put on hold at this point because of that and what it's generated around the world. So then you see the expression of that in terms of the campus rebellions and strikes that's been going on around. So it's really one of those things where they shot themselves in the foot. The Democrats are really in a bind because the basic that Biden needs to be reelected is are people who are protesting what's going on. And I think the Democrats are just relying on the fact that Trump is represents such open-faced fascism that people say, well, they won't vote for it. A lot of people know that they're not going to participate at all. I think that, so those forces that propel, we use anti-Semitism black protests that questions the status quo, threats to the status quo. So there, so it's not relevant to say that we face the same enemy. It's just in different form.
One thing I was reading recently about this thing that's happening, that always is happening between the parallel, between, you know, that trying to convince us that anti-Zionism is anti-Semitism, is that we can see that that's not the case. We open up our phones and we know that's not the case. So what's happening is the narrative that the imperialists have pushed is unraveling right before their faces. It does not have validity because everyone knows it's not true. So it's kind of like they'll keep saying it until enough of us believe it, but none of us are believing it. So we turn on CNN, we turn on the mainstream media, and they're still trying to reform an area that they don't have control over because the people have unraveled the area and created a new one with new language. And it's not even new. It's already been there, right? But the language has become readily available. So it's the same exact tactics that they're using of naming Palestinians terrorists, which was, again, a concept created by Netanyahu in his very early days. They said, let's create this concept of villainizing the victim to get the mainstream narrative. It did work for some time. The narrative has been dispelled. The majority of the world knows it. And so they're still going to keep talking to a mirror and teaching the same narrative that will not stick. So the question is, for how long will we allow the narrative to stay in the mainstream? Because the narrative will give in a little bit. They'll show articles on CNN about Trump and this, and then the eighth headline is something about, you know, some very vague thing happening in Gaza that's not specific and direct. But it's there, it's not the front line, it's not using our narrative that we claimed it. So this is an ideological battle that they've lost control over, and they're going to keep saying it because they have no other narrative that's going to work. The one that they had isn't working, it will continue not to work. So it's like, for how long will we just realize that we don't even have to be paying attention to these narratives? Because they lost control over it. We do have to know those people who still use that language to bring them over to our side. And I think Baba Jose always says, I always forget, he goes, align with the advance, went over the middle, and isolate the enemy, the back door. The back door are the people pushing the false narrative, right? So it's how do we win over those other people, right? Those middle people who could come over to our side. To officially put to rest this narrative that's been pushed for many, many, many years. Because it's inherent to their existence that these narratives live. And they're narratives that are based in ideology, and they're based, the very fabric of our nation is upheld on this narrative. And if they stop saying it, then the narrative dies, and so does the concept of America and the imperialism as a whole.
It's a propaganda war. And I think they keep spewing it with the protests, particularly the protests at the campuses and schools, put a lot to it, particularly when you have Jewish youths participating in the protests. So it creates an oxymoron, that it's certainly not anti-Semitic, but it certainly is anti-Zionist. It's really, this is always a struggle, particularly in the United States, particularly since the advent of the internet. There's so much information and disinformation. So people really generate information from their own bubble that reinforces what they want. But in events like the protests, the campus protests, it's something that they can't be ignored. And so that's just a question. Some people willfully are just maintaining their position in the face of reality. And it's a struggle to win over, as he said, win over the advance and bring the middle to the majority, the great majority to that. And those of us who consider ourselves organizers, that's what our job is, to use whatever forms possible. Social media, in the streets, demonstrations, to push over it. Honest people who are genuinely seeking information. Take that up, but parish of 151st Street, Harlem, said he would take government money for programs because once you get government money, there's too many strings attached. So if you want to have some independence, so we've done that, all this work, all this, you know, so that helps us save us, you know, eliminate the program. So Sister's Place in Brooklyn, where we're based, it's all voluntary, nobody's getting paid. You know, I think, you know, in an ideal world, it would be good to have an organization, professional revolutionaries that did nothing but do that.
See what it's for.
focus is going to take in 2024. That the real essence of the ideology of our ideology is that we need, as we have said, the concrete analysis of concrete conditions. And you can't just take something that was applied in one situation and apply it to your situation. You have to take the principles that were involved and then apply it to your situation. So, you know, we think the spirit right now is very, very, very important. We're encouraged by the fact that the student protests continue. I was telling one brother that when I started college, which was maybe 4 months after that, I came to get back in 68, and the issues were that the reserve officer training group, which was the proxy, was on all the campuses, so it was the fact of getting them off. These were the college students trained, so they come out and they would be lieutenants or whatever in the military. Just one of the drafts on. And African American studies was that it's just determination. And so in my freshman year, when the proposal was put to the administration that we needed to be an African American studies department, African American studies department, the administration laughed and said, well, you know, it's basically like you niggas don't have any history or anything. That's an essence of the second. And we said, that's not true. But it didn't get resolved until spring when students went out on strike. So my freshman year, all three semesters, we were out on strike around those two issues. And then my sophomore year, we were out on strike. At the end of the freshman year, they found the Department of African American Studies under protest, underfunded, but they were forced to do it because otherwise the university would have been shut down. And so, a program that began through struggle, that there were people involved in who really wanted it to be revolutionary, and there were people involved that just wanted it to be, become a regular academic, learn to cite Black Lives Matter, as I said. Please understand that you're really important. So, some people's position, please understand that there really is a Black history, African history that predated European intervention. And that's basically what might happen. You know, the department that we were fighting for in the first couple of years, I mean, we had a host of Africanism started by C.R. James, and we were in that at most places. But the United States' ability to absorb protests, so, you know, Black is beautiful, Black power, which is very radical, slowest in the time, then it became the Union Black Army, too. So that's the capacity of the United States. To, you know, they used to use that to recruit in the army. You know, you can be Black and in the army. So you can be Black and Navy. So that was their response to absorbing some of those radicals and bringing it into, how can we use this to push our agenda? So that's one of the things. That's what we have to be aware of when we're dealing with the United States and the propaganda world. Thank you. Young Lords. Another book, you know, Young Lords, the late 60s, early 70s. Some of the folks from the Lords, you know, been involved with this continuously. I remember Pablo, who was part of Young Lords, just passed a few months ago. He did a lot of stuff in media, and so did one.
One of those
when he used to work with the Daily News, he did a lot of things in this stuff with democracy now. So that people can have a continued push to expose the lies. You get in a movement of people who are long distance runners, folks who don't, you know, they drive out. But it doesn't change the fact that the movement has got to continue. And why it's very important that the information has got to be transmitted to younger people, because as long as I think it was our new chairperson, our chairperson, Adam Clayton Powell Jr. died in January, he said, you know, we're in the last what's happening. In opposition, we're doing the same thing in terms of our work to have that transmission of. And it's much different when I was young and involved in the movement, I sought, you know, information from older heads. And you know, be part of the young is you think you know everything. Really only realize you're in a squat, I mean, I think you're in a squat. So I didn't find that earlier on in terms of that transmission belt between older and younger folks, which I think is really crucial. The brother said in terms of young boys represented, we have to know that it's become to us suddenly as new. It means that we have to learn what was before us. So.
Okay, Rashid, I think it's fascinating, but I'm going to go back to immigration a little bit because you were, you know, exactly one of like three states that have an active commission about that right now. And to your point about information education and studying like commissions and applying the right strategies for now, I think people that don't know that we have a long history of funding commissions for recommendations that they don't follow through on when the recommendations come. So, what do you think about recommendations now as an organizing strategy, right? Because the other state of ethnic cleansing, or as you know, as education, where, you know, at different times, Brooklyn, Harlem, and the Bronx had a lot of nutrition of black people in this country, and that's no longer the case. So, how do you think moving forward, not just Black African organizations and African organizations, but the same that Black people devoted to solidarity and outside of other people going through oppression? One, how can Black African organizers as a public really, how should we handle this mission, right? Black business, like $5 million on. And how can other ethnicities support Black Africans in our Black organizations? And so the people of Boston and California are the two states that are containing the idea of commission. And California's task force estimates that Black people are owed $500 billion, right? Mm-hmm. Now, again, we find the Black people and look for here. That's part of the goal of the commission. They want to hear from people so the people can tell them who is Black, who's an African, who should get paid, how much, everything. So the organizing opportunity there is prime. But how should we handle that despite all of our ideological struggles? And as I said, we're going to differences, right? Because we're asking them, what is your better lesson?
This has been a lovely question, so people are thinking and sure. This is obviously where the whole reverse issue, that in the final analysis, to the extent that reparations are ever really going to be real, it's got to be done by the federal government, because the federal government made all that possible. So in doing so, we had a campaign to raise that issue right after Biden was elected. And Biden had, I don't know if you remember when Biden was elected, he said, oh, and I couldn't. When I was down, the Black community supported me, and I was the president was for you have my back, I'll have yours, right? And so we had a campaign called, it was called that Biden needed to sign an executive order to put down a $50 billion down payment on reparations. We had your back, you can't define what you have our back as you. So, and that was the demand, and the idea being that $50 billion is simply a down payment. It's nowhere near what's owed, what's due. And we wanted to focus on the issue of health provision of state-of-the-art health facilities around the country because we thought that the particular of health, somebody asked about health, the particular of health affects everybody. It affects you directly, it affects your relatives, friends, and that we suffer. And we see that by the intervention earlier, the system that we need that in our community, and our community will be healthy college before 1989, which didn't even provide for a crisis, provided for a study of whether we do have a crisis. It's an update on that to talk about remedies. But this, in 1989, he was the chair of the committee that the bill came out of. By 1992, Clinton was president. He had a Democratic president. He had a Democratic House. He had a Democratic Senate. The bill never came out of the committee. And when all the stars lined up, never came out of the committee. So now, it's in the committee, it's still in the committee. And you know, nothing like that's going to come out of this Congress. So, our view was executive order. Well, everybody knows executive order. The president can do that. He saw the money he sent to. You know, he sent to Israel, money sent to Ukraine, because he can do that, he's the executive. And so that was our demand, because we really did the focus issue on health care and reparations, something that helps everybody get to what reparations is about. And it bypassed all the congressional stuff, and it made Biden deal with his, you have my back, I'm going to have yours. But it won't raise people's mind, it's the U.S. government. That's got to be responsible for all these different small things, state level, some cities have stuff, in the sense that it has people thinking about reparations as positive, but in the sense that it allows folks to say, oh, we got our reparations, we can get reparations. Really, it's negative because that's not it. I think Georgetown decided they were going to give students whose parents are. The enslaved Africans they sold so that they could maintain themselves. That would be reparations. It's got to be more than that. And by making it broader than that, because our position is that reparations, we suffered a collective injury. We were victims of a collective injury. And that the repairs had to be good, like the cancer we were based upon. But if you last name was with you, documented that your parents were enslaved in South Carolina. You know, we brought a lawsuit in 2002 against 17 corporations who could tie their existence, their current existence, to the fact that they profited from the transfer of unsaturated slavery. And it got dismissed finally, lost, because the plaintiffs could not document that they were tied to a particular level of whatever those corporations were. It's absurd, right? You know, the term is called standard question. But if there's no, you know, and we think it's not simply tied to prior to the Civil War, but after the Civil War, right? From to the current times, in terms of continuation of Jim Crow and racism, so that you get away from legacy, you get away from Jehovah's Witness, forget it, you get away from. All of the ways that people can disparage dealing with it and dealing with it, black people, you know, are due reparations. And if you deal with them collectively, on a collective area, if you deal with health care, you get away from it, you get a check in your mailbox. Because you said that's, you can't really deal with it that way, and it's too divisive. Because you have people away from the New York State Reparations Commission. We supported that, but more importantly, we'll monitor the commission's bill, but we're going to continue to do reparations for the community, you know, for the last 30 years, you know. And so we had a meeting last month, a citywide meeting, people came to talk about what the commission was doing, what it is that we still need to do in terms of, in our communities, having discussions on reparations, having local meetings. To prepare people for it, understand that reparations has got to be on a national level. So that work is going to continue regardless of what the commission is going to do. As someone just pointed out, New York State, they just provided money for the commission, receiving the money in the budget for the New York Reparations Commission. They're supposed to come out with remedies. The question will then be enforcement of those remedies. So it's a continuing battle, but it's also an education. Our community, because it keeps the issue of reparations real, because when it was 25 years ago, people put that so high in the sky, they didn't deal with it. Now it's because some people can see, actually, can be done. And of why the United States was forcibly was not simply the military. But the really the question of international opinion change, the discussions that were going on in Paris created an atmosphere around the world where the United States had to withdraw. And I remember reading a time where it was a military man from Vietnam, this is years after the war, but it's a military man from the United States, and a guy from the United States said, you know, you never beat us in any major battle. And he said, the guy from Vietnam said, that's true, but we won the war. And that war was not simply on the battlefield, it was the international public opinion of all the allies played in terms of its best. I don't have a handbook or layout in terms of that. I do recognize, our position recognizes the necessity of it. And I think it's up to us as organizers to see how we facilitate that. It has to happen. It does not mean that because somebody comes from a white community that they say they have the answers. Because this isn't just racism around the other ones you're doing. You need us to start laughing. If you get white folks who are, you know, prepared to deal with that, then you can have a real legitimate for lives. So that's your mission.
And we want to honor that you do some of that work. Just a month ago, we had a Hawaiian siblings here drawing the parallels between the Hawaiian freedom struggle, the Puerto Rican freedom struggle. 2 days ago, I went to a musical band that was a revolutionary band between Filipinas and Puerto Ricans, and they were soulfully singing "Free, Free Puerto Rico" with all these different instruments. You know, so again, going back to the music, right, sister's place, those things play a big role when we bring our cultures together and motivate each other to be together. And my question, is about your relationship with the law and the cops. Because I know that the Black Power March from Malcolm X is a no permit. There's no purpose, right? Okay, so if you can tell us about points where you did or didn't have a permit, because when we're thinking about our farmers that are right now at One Police Plaza, they have not operated their projects since, I don't know, July? But 3 years in that time, like here in Harlem, they shut it down, they didn't go home for 8 months without a permit. And they said the other day, yesterday, that they are doing it without. Or the Air Force said they had to shut this down. Maybe they weren't going to shut it down, but escalated tensions built one person to shut another person. And more so, when I went to go be with our young people, they come from ideologies that sometimes exacerbate the very institutions that we're against in terms of anarchist leaning. You know, mudslinging, talking about your mama to the cops, and I'm like, I can't imagine Bob Roger over here talking about your mama at a day. So part of it is how do we move in strategy with the law when you or do we not get permits? You know, what is the attitude that we knowingly know that these folks come from trying to enslave, re-enslave free people, right, the NYPD and all the cops, knowing that the very institution is very weak, the foundation is very weak, but how do we still work with them knowing that they have material force, and how do we navigate those things strategically, and how maybe we have the office navigated. And the same thing with Hala, going into a building without having the full legal backing of a full equip piece, and when you get evicted from your spot, how do you navigate a system where we know we have title to that building, but then according to the law, we're in a grip where there's fighting culture. That's what they always done with indigenous people. Well, we got a contract, and these people signed it, and nah, they didn't know that they were signing it, was a setup, and it's just part of your system of manipulation. So just kind of playing with the institution and playing our rules, knowing that we are
strategically despised, or tactically you deal with it. So
This whole thing since 2020, which I just thought was very interesting, because in 2020 they basically gave up requiring people to permits to be sent. Under the law, sound permits are not for moving demonstrations that they relax it during political campaigns. Sound permits are for specific areas. But they choose when to enforce it or not. Now they're starting to enforce it more. I think that's because the mayor wants to make a point that he's the sheriff of town and nobody can tell him anything. So it's exactly how you do. With May 19th, we got parade permits, and sound permits. And then over the years, we've had different relationships. At one point, I forget, was it when Giuliani? I think it was when Giuliani was saying, the police were going to the store to tell you, don't have to close, you don't have to close. And then they back off of that. And now, sometimes they go and tell us, I really should close. You're going to have people out from your store. So then we get to regulate and talk with them. They understand that we maintain our own security. When we run the street, we do. We maintain our own security. We don't have to be involved. And we handle any sort of disturbances and stuff. So we really minimize them being that they close the street. Usually at some point, we go, we're not past Boulevard, and then history. We just circle for a few minutes and stop all traffic. And they basically go along with it. Who knows if this year may change. But we've become accustomed to that. We do this, this is happening. In one sense, I don't think they have a fundamental contradiction around that, around the source closing. I think they have a fundamental contradiction around what we represent. So it's never a problem of, oh, we can just trust them, they're going to protect us. But what is it that we want to do? Is what we want to do as source closers, is what we want to do as people arrested. Our organization, because we come out of having been political prisoners, we really don't go into a symbolic arrest. Like, get arrested and be arrested. That, because we know how we get treated once we're inside an institution, so there's no purpose for that. There's some things that you take, you run the risk of arrest, and then, if that happens, then you're prepared to deal with it. But to be arrested just for the sake of being arrested, I don't know what happened with the people I know. Last summer, they do a distribution in right around from our 4 blocks from our office, on North Street in Fulton, and they have been doing a distribution. And this week, the police decided they didn't want to do it, but I'm still not clear on all the details of it, because where they set up, it's on the street, and it's a bus stop. They're not in the bus stop, they're on the street. But the police acted, they acted for the police. But from what I understand, the part of it was, they asked somebody to move, they didn't want to move, and then it's just stuff broke from there. So one of them got arrested there, and then at the precinct, three or four more people got arrested because when they were taking, they were planning. But when they were taking the person who was arrested in, they just jumped, like they were going to stop the police from taking them to the precinct. And that's just stupid, So they ended up getting arrested. Then they had a plan of, they were going to stop the police cars taking them from the precinct to Central Booking. At which point, and I was involved with that, I said, that's completely correct. You don't even know when they're going to take. But the idea that, so what is the point? I mean, they're already in arrest, right? What is the point of being arrested for trying to stop this from taking people to Central Booking? Because you're not going to do it, and then you're going to have even more arrests. So the question is, and people come with different agendas, because some people's agenda is, we want to get more people arrested, more people arrested, the better, that they think that exposes the population. Let me give you an example. The first day of outbreaks was back in 1987. And as Clinton said in the introduction, the idea was no business as usual in New York while we're getting shot and everything. And we met in Brooklyn at Cavern Plaza with 1,500 people. But we had already had a plan of how it was going to shut down the traffic. We spoke, we had people who were in the remote, more than motor women. There were people who were going to talk about pulling the cords. We had people who were going to go to bridges. We had not a lot of people in New York, but they knew it was going to come to the demonstration. And this is back in the time they had tokens. We had tokens and things. We said they were going to bring a token. We did not want people to get arrested for jumping the turnstile. So they could stop people and say, you jump the turnstile, you know. And so that eliminated that. And at some point, we went down on the tracks. They had turned all the electricity because we were on the tracks. But nobody got arrested from them. But they got arrested from them. Was that there was a group of people in the fibers. There was a group that involved Reverend Sharpton and some other noted attorneys who were going, they wanted to symbolic arrest. And we said, we really want to have symbolic arrest. But if that's what you want to do, your group did the symbolic arrest. And so, their group was supposed to go over to the Clark Street subway, right? Others were going to the main other major subways. And Reverend Sharpton saw that there were no press over at where they were. And basically, because he had his own notoriety, he had been part of us, you know, when we did the demonstration in Newburgh. And our person who was in charge of that wasn't his own mother. So he basically commandeered the group and took them over to J Street, where the other group was, and then where they did belong, and they jumped the turnstiles. So then that gave the police an excuse, a justification of arresting. So like 100 people got arrested. That wasn't necessary. We did everything else that we were going to do in terms of people who were in the tracks and stuff like that. We went to the bridge. Such as back to all of us in Europe. You know, and that event was done, but nobody had ever been arrested at that point. Nobody even worse was that very sharp and I would be other nameless people thought that they were going to be able to walk out of prison. The other issue said, your ass is going nowhere until everybody is released. Because they had taken people and put them all over Brooklyn, the people they arrested. So it wasn't until everybody had arrested that release that they were released. But it was that breaking discipline, because the objective was not to have people arrested for that, you know. And it wasn't necessary. So that's the tactics you work out. You just have to get that real clear understanding of what it is that you want to do. But there's really no purpose. We're not back in civil rights era around just getting arrested. It's but sometimes you can't avoid it, and you just be prepared to deal with that when, if that happens. People in place, usually lawyers, counselors, as well as a lot of people. Sometimes you have civil liberties. And I guess if anything you want to prepare people for, if you're in administration, don't have a backpack. Don't carry all of your, you want to have a piece of ID. You want to have, you know, what we always call it was have Dodge or get out of Dodge or back then it was $50. So you just want to have something like that, ID, and very little else. So you keep up the phones down. And that you need them in one sense, another sense, you know, especially if your phones are like, they can always get inside your phone, so there's no thing around your cell encrypted that they can't get you, you can throw down the signal. Everything that's developed in man-made and man-made to it, it's not only yourself, it's incredible. And you travel light. And you have some sort of number that people can call to make sure that somebody can be there when you go to the precinct to deal with it. So. Well, in terms of mayor, it's successful. We get almost 100% compliance in terms of the sewers along there. Because it's limited, it's not like we have to shut down the whole thing. But one time I think we did it for like 6 hours, 4 hours. So it's, you know, it's limited. So people can, they look at it. And like I said, it's really a statement that we can make this happen, and we do it every year. And it also extends the time when some stores don't comply. We have picket in front of the stores, and that continues the idea that the community can enforce. Because we're supposed to go to basically a holiday, you know, but it's not even 4 days. We call it a moment of commercial silence in honor of them. How do you apply that to source shed in terms of the current motion on the power side? I guess that would have to be a discussion in terms of what stores, why, how long, is it selective, is it, it's just that I couldn't give a general answer on it. That would really require who you ask to shut down, why, where, for how long, how can you enforce that? That's another question of strategy and tactics, I think. If that's one thing that I hope people take from it, is to understand the question of strategy, long range tactics. Your strategy is your principle, but it doesn't change just like that, but the tactics is the flexibility. So Malcolm talked about by any means necessary, that literally means by any means necessary, that's a reflection of tactics. And that's what I think may be missing in terms of some of the things that are going on now in terms of people's understanding.
Thank you, Brother Roger. Really appreciate that. And from the last conversation, because over a lot of us organizers in here, possibly doing a lot of local work, organizing the ground in our communities. So we really want to learn how to effectively do demonstrations, how do we effectively know why are we doing these tactics, and not to be in the rest of the organization. At least that we're looking forward to it, because we already are ready for those. And because there's a lot of people with the encampments. We have talked about many conversations that a lot of the students was not ready for the brutality that was supposed to come from the police, right? And that's part of our lesson. A lot of people just organizing, but we don't know what's to come for some of these things that are about to get into, the things that we want to do.
Yeah, that's important, because I know I had a comrade who was at NYU, and this was before he got arrested, but he was in one of the arrested. At some point, she had thought she wanted to be arrested, but she called and said, I'm not ready to get arrested. If I'm not ready to get arrested, then don't. Because the worst thing in the world is to be in a situation like that when you had doubts about why you're doing it. And you have to be prepared for it. This is what this may represent. You may have a criminal record, you may face expulsion, you may face suspension. So that when people do stuff, they've done it with a clear understanding of these are the possible consequences, because if not, then they leave with feeling they've been betrayed, they just move to the other side around as a personal citizen. And so that's very important. And the people are one of the support mechanisms that are going to be in place if you get arrested. Too, it's college students, because it's not just them dealing with their family and all the things from that.
How do people care for one team? What are they going to expect when they get there? And the importance of following discipline. Discipline and following leadership, especially in these situations.
And in addition, it's an assignment you should do to reverse dress code and proper phone medication. You're taking pictures, not taking pictures.
Well, that's another good one. Yeah. When we do our demonstrations, before we move out, we give people the orders of the day. We basically have can't follow those rules, then you should step off. That we have security, we have people who are designated as head of security. The purpose of the security is to ensure the protection of the people who are marching with us. And so the security, so people who told these rules, for example, depending on the number of people, we may be marching single file, maybe marching two abreast, maybe marching three abreast, and people are told these are the security people who have to follow their instructions. If something breaks out, the security will handle it. If something happens with the police, there are people, even on security, everybody's got to deal with the police, there are people who are designated to deal with it. So it's no longer ranges. So it's basically to follow the orders of security. And if you can't do that, then you just, you know, they want to sidelines. If you can't maintain the discipline of the formation, you know, if you want to bring your bicycle in, you can't bring your bicycle in. But a bicycle demonstration is a hazard. If something happens, people turn over bicycles, and you're not going to ride up on your own. So there's certain things like that. So certainly, you have to follow orders, because that's the only way we're going to be able to maintain your security. And if you're just too individualistic, or feel I don't follow any kind of authority anywhere, this is the wrong place to be in. Dress code is, people can wear pretty much what they want. If you have flyers, you need to clear with security about what you can distribute that might be. And what we do is if we need a 12, in front of the sales club, we rally there, we do the march for those 3 hours, stop at different places, and then we come back to the sales club and finish the summation. At which point, when people make different announcements, hands up things. It's not while we're marching, folks have other flyers. How many people designated to get our flyers? We want people who are marching, break through the line, go through the line, and that stuff. So, you just need to clarify with the organizers about what it is you have, and you know, what you want to hand out. And people have a chance to see it at the end or sum it up. But the actual motion of those one to four. You know, that control in terms of just being able to do that. So you get no dress code. Yeah, you can bring signs, and you know, when you come, we'll just see if there's no contradiction with that. You know, if there is, you can just see it right there. A lot of people right at the city office the entire time. So just see. Yeah, but at the end of the day, because I know, you know, a couple of times out there, it was, you know, we're doing a summation. Different people would come and say, oh, you know, something. Like, there was a sister from South Africa who was there, maybe 2 years ago, who was part of the struggle there, and she spoke, you know, but it's not interesting like that. We didn't know what was happening. We do this so there's rain, snow, whatever. So, no umbrellas, bring a poncho or something. Sometimes we supply, but if it's going to rain, and you got umbrellas, is not, you know. So nobody does demonstrations with an umbrella. This reminded me of 89 when there was the king was going on strike because the governor. There were people that were institutional killing. And
We don't waste our time on 125th Street, but you can reach more people in the street who want to change than you can in the bourgeoisie society, the bourgeoisie church, and the bourgeoisie circles. Our program is directed toward the man in the street. So we spend our time in the street, and what we do with that man, instead of trying to change the white man in your mind and make you accept us, we change the mind of the black man and make him accept himself. And as soon as he accepts himself, he'll solve his own problem. He won't be trying to force himself into your factory and into your bedroom and into your kitchen.
Shut up, man.